Good afternoon, everyone. We have gathered here today to have a discussion on Chapter 2 of the Volume 1 of the Economic Survey of 2018, which is based on the impact of GST, that is the recently introduced Goods and Services Tax, on the Indian economy. Let us start this discussion by introducing ourselves. My name is Sarthak Jain, and my PRN is 1095.
My name is Shantam Basandrai, and my PRN is 1100.
My name is Pratik Tale, my PRN is 1104.
My name is Tamal Ghosh, my PRN is 1105.
My name is Anand Kumar Singh, and my PRN is 1107.
My name is Gaurav Deshpande, and my PRN is 1123.
So I would like to start this discussion by saying that the overall impact of GST has been quite positive on the Indian economy. One of the greatest apprehensions of GST was that GSDP, that states with a high GSDP, that is gross state domestic products, would suffer under the new regime. But as the recently released figures show, that the distribution of the GST base is linked to the GSDP, which put all these apprehensions to rest. I would like Shantam to further elaborate on the same point.
Yes, this was a concern. In the run-up to the GST, there was an anxiety amongst the manufacturing states that a switch to a destination or a consumption-based tax, which is the GST, would transfer the tax base towards the consuming states. However, the data shows that the top states are still Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu in terms of the tax base. So this validates the point that each state's share in the GST base is almost perfectly correlated with its share in the overall GSDP. And so the biggest tax bases still seem to be the biggest producing states.
One interesting thing to see that the share of Maharashtra and Gujarat's tax base is much lower than their share of manufacturing. The theory suggests that the tax base under the GST should be in correlation with their share of manufacturing. But because these two states also have a significant presence in their services, which their tax base remains in line with their share of GSDP, that is gross state domestic product. Overall, the data seem to suggest fairness and balance is GST overcomes.
So most of the discussion in the run-up to the GST is centered on the size of the tax base and its implication on the revenue neutral rate. Now the RNR committee, it is headed by the chief economic advisor, Dr. Arvind Subramaniam, who submits report to the finance minister. Now the RNR committee has estimated the base tax of around 68.8 lakh crores, where the GST council has estimated the base of rupees 65.8 lakh crores. So the current data suggests that the GST tax base is 65 to 70 lakh crores, which is broadly similar to those previous estimates. Now, based on the average collection in the first few months, the implied weighted average collection rate is about 15.6%. So the estimated by RNR committee, the single tax rate would preserve revenue.
So now I would like to discuss the tax base in the new system. By the end of December 2017, there were 9.8 million GST registrations, which is slightly higher than the number of registrations in the old system. But one major factor in the old system was that you could have multiple registrations under the central and the state level. This has been completely eliminated in the new system. So if you take this factor into account, there are about 3.4 million new registrations, which is quite an impressive number. And out of these 3.4 million, 30% are export businesses, 34% are B2B filers, and 17% are B2B filers. As I said before, that these are quite impressive numbers, and the numbers are further expected to improve in the forthcoming years.
Now, one of the many benefits of GST was the voluntary compliance it would elicit. Now, there are about 1.7 million registrants who are below the threshold limit, that is, and hence not obliged to register, but still, nevertheless, they choose to do so. Indeed, out of the total estimated 71 million non-agricultural enterprises, it is estimated that around 13% are registered in GST.
Now further, we see that 1.6 million taxpayers are registered under the composition scheme, the current threshold of which is nearly about 1.5 crores. So they pay a small tax on their turnover and they are not eligible to pay the input tax credits. All this has made them a regular filers and has put them under the composition scheme. Now talking about the registration, the maximum number of GST registrations has come from Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, UP, Gujarat. And talking about the 3.4 million registrations, it has seen increase in UP and West Bengal are the top two increased states in terms of GST registrations, which all these put together, we see that GST has a positive influence on our country.
So a large increase has been witnessed in the indirect taxpayers. And this especially is in the case of the small enterprises, which buy from the large ones and they get to avail the input tax credits. So overall, a positive trend is being witnessed, and it is expected that the tax collection would increase as the years go by.
So I would like to introduce the new topic, which is the size distribution of inter-firm transaction. Now, what is an inter-firm transaction? When there is a transaction between the two firms, it is called as an inter-firm transaction, and it is not an intra-firm transaction. For example, if supplier sells to a buyer, then it is an inter-firm transaction. And what is the size distribution of a firm? Now, the size distribution of a firm are the cumulative result of underlying firm dynamics, which involves the entry of new firms, growth of the new firms, decline of the firms, and exit of the firms. Now, knowing the nature of transaction between the firm is critical to formulate the policy, especially designing compliance procedure. So all the firms are based in five categories, which is based on their annual revenues. So the firm which is having annual revenue which is less than 20 lakh, it is called as a below threshold firm. The firm which is having the revenue of around 20 lakhs to 1 crore, it is called as a below composition limit firm. The firm which is having the annual revenue of 1 to 5 crore, it is called as a SME, that is a small and micro enterprise. The medium enterprise is having the annual revenue of 5 to 100 crores, and the large firms are having the revenue of above 100 crores.
Unsurprisingly, the data shows that the distribution of turnover is very skewed. Why is that? Because the registered below threshold firms account for 32% of total firms, but less than 1% of total turnover. Whereas the largest account for less than 1% of firms has 66% of turnover and 54% of tax liability. The results show that registered small firms seems to be equally involved in selling to consumer, that is B2C, and selling to other firms, that is B2B. Whereas medium and large firms, in contrast, have a much greater presence in B2B than B2C transactions. These data is with us because of the post-GST. Now we can segregate the B2C consumers and B2B, that is selling to other firms, because of the GST data.
Now coming to the B2B and B2C segments, we have seen that small dealers who sell directly to customers, which is B2C mainly, they would come under the composition scheme, while the B2B and other sectors, which are the bigger firms, they get into the regular registration process, which is because they do not have the capability to pay the input tax credit rates. So basically here, all this has meant that both the B2B and B2C segments are separate after the GST has come in.
Now it turns out that about half the transactions of the below threshold firms, which nonetheless voluntarily chose to comply, are actually in the B2C space. This suggests that there are in fact other motivations for participation beyond simply being a supplier to larger companies or firms.
And hence, all these small B2C firms want to be a part of the GST because they actually buy from the large enterprises. In fact, 68% of their purchases are from medium and large registered enterprises, which gives them a powerful incentive to register so that they could now secure an input tax credits on their purchases.
So, let's talk about a new topic: international trade, interstate trade, and economic prosperity of post-GST. This year, GST returns provides direct data on interstate and its many related dimensions. Interstate trade is estimated to generate 54% of overall GDP. In fact, most of the cases, interstate trade between two contiguous states exceeds than intrastate trade. The data is surprising because of removal of one of the major roadblocks, that is cascading effects and different taxes in different states, thus resulting in the ease of doing business. Even more exciting is that for the first time in India's history, it is possible to know state-wise international exports of goods and services. Five states, that is Maharashtra, Gujarat, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Telangana, in that order account for almost 70% of India's exports, leading by Maharashtra 22.3%, Gujarat 17.2%, Karnataka 12.7%, Tamil Nadu 11.5% and Telangana 6.4%.
So I would like to talk about the interstate and intrastate trades. Now the interstate supply of goods and services is when the location of the seller and the location of the buyer is in the same state. So the seller charges CGST and IGST to the buyer. And in the intrastate supply of goods and services, when the location of the supplier and the location of the buyer is in a different state, so the seller charges IGST to the buyer. So due to the GST, the process of interstate has become smooth. Pre-GST, the complex tax structure and paperwork forced transport industry to spend a lot of resources and tax compliance and deposit an interstate sales tax. Now, monitoring and collection of these taxes was very much difficult and led to the major traffic congestion at these points, resulting in slow movement of freight. Now, Indian trucks covers around 50 to 60,000 kilometers per year, where the trucks in US covers around 2 lakh kilometers per year. Now, this has become possible because of GST in India, that Indian trucks has become agile, and the because of the GST, the process has really become agile in India. Given the data are available for the first time, one can immediately answer whether the prosperity is related to the export performance. Now, state GSDP per capita is highly correlated with the export share. The state which has higher export has higher GSDP. One major outlier is Kerala. The Kerala is much ahead in polymer manufacturing, food processing, etc. So the Kerala has an export of around $6 million and its GSDP per capita is 11.5 USD.
Now the fact with Kerala is because it is a large recipient of remittances. If remittances are added and created for a broader globalization index for states, Kerala may not be an outlier. Now, India's exports are unusual in the fact that the largest funds account for much smaller share of exports than in other countries. Top 1% of Indian firms account only for 38% of exports, unlike in other countries where they account for substantially greater share. For example, 72% in Brazil, 68% in Germany, 67% in Mexico, and 55% in USA.
Continuing with the interstate discussion started by Pratik, the five largest exporting states are Maharashtra, Gujarat, Haryana, Tamil Nadu, and Karnataka. Whereas if you look at the five largest importing states, they are again Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, Karnataka, and Gujarat. And the states with the largest internal trade surpluses are Gujarat, Haryana, Maharashtra, Odisha, and Tamil Nadu. If you analyze this data, two interesting questions arise. First, are the states that export the most, are they the ones that import the most? Second, and the states that trade the most, are they the ones that are the most competitive and run the largest trade surpluses? The answer to both these questions lie in statistics. If we use statistics, we would find that there is a correlation between the share of exports and the share of imports, and the correlation factor is 0.93. This proves that the states that have a larger share of imports have a corresponding larger share of exports also.
Now coming to the trading superstars, which is basically the export firms in today's Indian egalitarian economy. What is meant by trading superstar? This is basically the export firms which have a disproportionately large amount of exports that they get out of the country. Basically, surveys have found that top 1% of exporting firm account for 50% of the total exports done in India. So why is this? Because fostering this business influences the sectorial composition to improve and gives India the competitive advantage. So nowadays we see that not only small firms like MSME but also big companies like in B2C and B2B are also having a good effect on the tax structure simply because a new GST has come into the picture.
So now the important thing to note here is that until now such an analysis was not possible in India because the firm level export data was very difficult to gather. However, with the introduction of the GST, it is now possible to create such firm level data. Another point in this is that the findings show that the export concentration by firms in India is much lower as compared to the firms in US, Mexico, Germany and Brazil.
So going forward the point, we see that top 1% of firms account for near about 70% of exports for Brazil, Germany, US and Mexico, whereas in India it only accounts for 38% of overall exports and top 5% of firms account for near about 85 to 90% of exports for Brazil, Germany, US and Mexico, whereas in India it only accounts for 60% of overall exports. When we talk about top 25% of firms which accounts for exports, for these four countries, that is Brazil, USA, Mexico and Germany, they account for 95 to 98% of overall exports, whereas in India it only accounts for 80% of overall exports in India. So these data show us that because of GST we got to know these set of data, but India has to go major steps towards the exports with respect to the account of firms that they are contributing in the exports, and to get in line with these four developed countries.
This may be because Indian data exclude exports of cereals, unlike others where concentration ratios tend to be lower. Now, such egalitarian exceptionalism of Indian export argues in favor of export firms because they are dynamic and they are expansion, and their expansion can have spillover effects on other firms or companies.
Earlier, traders were having disputes with the government whether to pay the taxes to the goods or the services. But now, traders have no dispute whether the tax is on goods or services because it is now applicable to both under GST. Now, composition level increased, so the turnover increased, which is beneficial for the traders for generating the revenue. No cascading effect. One tax structure is good to manufacture, reduction in cost, minimization of classification issues, and the state-wise registration has also been beneficial to the manufacturers.
Now coming to the next topic of informality of Indian economy. Informality or rather formality can be defined in at least two senses. First, when firms are providing some kind of social security to employees, the government of India provides it through EPFO. That is Employee Provident Fund Organization. This in respect of pensions and provident funds. And the second one is ESIC, that is Employee State Insurance Corporation, in respect of medical benefits. Now coming to EPFO, the EPFO contribution is mandatory for industries employing greater than 20 workers and whose monthly wage is below Rs. 15,000. Above this level, contributions are voluntary. Of the total active members, 86% earn less than Rs. 15,000 and about 98% have opted for combination of the Provident Fund pension option. Coming to ESIC, the ESIC contribution is mandatory for firms employing greater than 10 workers and whose monthly wage is below Rs.
21,000. As Anand has already elaborated on the first definition, now I would like to shed some light on the second definition. So another definition of formality is when firms are part of the tax net. So under the current regime, it would be those firms which fall under the GST ambit. Based on these definitions, the magnitude of formal sector firms turnover, tax liabilities and some other data can be calculated, which has illustrated some key findings. 0.6% of the firms, they account for 38% of total turnover, 87% of the exports and 63% of the GST liability. They lie in the hardcore formal sector, that is, they are both in the tax and the social security net. On the other hand, 87% of the firms, which represent 21% of the total turnover, they are purely informal, that is, they lie outside both the tax and the social security net.
Now further continuing with the statistics, around 12% of the firms which account for 41% of the turnover, 13% of exports and 37% of tax liabilities are only in the tax net but not in the social security net. These are the firms which are relatively smaller than those which are present in both the sets, nets, since they have a lower average turnover and an average tax rate. And finally, less than 0.1% of the firms which account for around 14% of the turnover are in the social security net only, but not in the tax net. These are mostly the firms that are in the GST exempted sectors, which include education, health and electricity.
So coming to the non-farm payroll, the former non-farm payroll system from a social security perspective is estimated at about 7.5 crores or 31% of non-agricultural workforces. This estimates includes government non-farm payrolls, that is central plus state, which is estimated at 1.5 crore excluding defense personnel. Tax base number estimate government employees and also non-farm payroll that takes place in sectors currently outside GST, such as health and education. If firms in these sectors also registers for other reasons, they will be part of estimated non-farm payroll, thus increasing the total of total taxpayers and increasing the GST tax base.
Now taking all into this account and adding another factor, which is government employment, the formal non-farm payroll is estimated from this tax definition is near about 13 million. That means almost 53% would come from the non-agricultural sector of the workforce. Now, it is very important to note that all these things are taken into account only from the enterprise-based point of view and not from the household-based definitions of employment. And sometimes we exclude the agricultural sector as well. Now, coming to this non-farm formal payroll system, it ranges from 31% in terms of social security and 53% in terms of tax-based definitions. So we see that both the GST has increased all the range of both the informality sectors, and India has already become an economy which is living up to its reputations.
Now coming to the conclusion, we discussed several points such as taxpayers, how they get affected by the GST, tax base and its spatial distribution, size distribution of inter-firm transactions, international trade, trading superstars and information on Indian economy. Now these points are mere a sampler giving hint on insights of GST. Now whole new world has been opened up to the followers of Indian economy, and much exciting new research lies ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.